very good evening, students. Now we are on the gluteal region, okay? And in this gluteal region, one of the clinical sign, what is called as Trendelenburg sign, is important, sometimes asked as a short note. And to understand what is the Trendelenburg sign, one has to understand what is the action of the two muscles in the gluteal region, which are called as gluteus medius and minimus. So this is a question, a short question of course, write about the gluteus medius and minimus and explain the positive Trendelenburg sign. So if this thing is there, then you have to write it under the headings introduction, and then I will go to about the gluteus medius, will describe then gluteus minimus, and lastly then we will learn what is the Trendelenburg sign. Okay, so let us come to the introduction. Now, since these two muscles which are responsible for the abduction of the thigh at the hip joint are the gluteus medius and minimus. The gluteus maximus, which is the large muscle in the gluteal region, is for the extension of the hip joint, okay? But these two muscles, they are abductor, strong abductor of the hip joint, and as we will see that they are responsible for the production of the Trendelenburg sign. You must have observed some of the people walking not with the straight gait or normal gait, but some of the people, they are walking what is called as the lurching gait, okay? And this lurching gait, if somebody is walking with the lurching gait, you can suspect that that person must be having the paralysis of the two muscles, that is abductor muscles of the gluteal region, gluteus medius and minimus, okay, due to the injury probably to that of the superior gluteal nerve, okay, superior gluteal nerve, right. So let us come first to the description of the gluteus medius muscle, okay. I have just shown you the lateral aspect in this diagram of the ilium, okay. So we are seeing the hip bone from the lateral aspect. Just you see here, this is the hip bone and it is the ilium part of the hip bone, and this is, we are seeing it from the lateral aspect. Now the outer surface of the ilium, it is having three lines, okay, and these three lines I will show you. This is called as the posterior gluteal line, behind which takes the origin the gluteus maximus, okay. That is not our, I mean to say, muscle to understand today. So this is the posterior gluteal line, and then from this greater sciatic notch, okay, if you can see, I can see here, there is a bony ridge is seen here which is going like this. See this? This is called as the anterior gluteal line. So our muscle, okay, it takes origin, that is the gluteus medius muscle, it takes origin from this area, that is called as the area between the posterior and anterior gluteal line. So this is the site of the origin of the gluteus medius muscle, okay. So this is the origin of the gluteus medius muscle, okay. Now this gluteus medius muscle, after taking its origin from here, okay, just let me draw it, then it will go downwards, forwards and laterally. So this is the site of the origin of the gluteus medius, a thick muscle, okay. And this is the muscle of choice for intramuscular injection because it lies in front of the gluteus maximus, and then deep to it are not very important nerves and vessels, so it is safe site. I mean, say the vessels are there, but nerves are not that important. So this muscle is a choice of, I mean, it's a muscle of choice for injection of the intramuscular injection. Now this muscle is running, okay, laterally and then downwards and slightly forward, and then a strong tendon of which becomes a strong tendinous insertion onto an oblique line which is present onto the lateral aspect of the greater trochanter. I have drawn the femur as seen from the lateral aspect. See this. This is the femur, and if you see it from the lateral aspect to the upper end of the femur, you can note there is a oblique ridge is present, and this oblique ridge is the site on which the gluteus medius muscle is attached. Okay, gluteus medius. Okay, now since this is of the opposite side and the diagram is of opposite side, the direction of this ridge is forwards and downward. Okay, and to this side, it is the attachment of the tendon of the gluteus medius on the lateral aspect of the greater trochanter, lateral aspect. Okay, so this is the site of the insertion. What is its nerve supply? This is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. Okay, it is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve, right? Then action. Okay. Since this muscle, okay, in this diagram you can see, which is a coronal section roughly drawn. Okay, this is the head of the femur, this is the acetabular fossa, so this is the site for the hip joint, and then this is the ilium. Okay, and these are the two muscles which are taking origin, diagrammatically represented, and going on to the greater trochanter. Okay, so this muscle is the gluteus medius, about which we are learning. So it is coming from ilium and then getting attachment onto the lateral aspect of the greater trochanter. So whenever it will contract, if this muscle gluteus medius will contract, this is the sign for contraction. If it will contract, that means two ends, origin and insertion, will get approximated, because it will, the length of this muscle will shorten up to 30%. So because of that, this will move this femur towards the lateral side. And if from the median plane, if anything moves away from the median plane, that movement is called as abduction. So this action is at is a powerful abductor of the thigh, at which joint? At the hip joint. Okay, a powerful abductor of thigh at the hip joint, of course, when the foot is off the ground. Okay, foot is off the ground. Now see the reverse action of this muscle. Whenever it will act from, by keeping its insertion fixed onto the lateral aspect of the greater trochanter, okay, then this muscle will try to bring, okay, what it will do? It will tilt the pelvis, okay, or the hip bone, which is in living condition is an articulated hip. Okay, so it will try to bring the hip bone towards the femur, so that means hip will be tilted. Okay, hip will be tilted to the side on which this contraction is taking place. Suppose it is the right side, so the hip will be tilted towards the right side. Okay, when it is acting from insertion. Okay, right? Okay, then we come to the second muscle, that is called as gluteus minimus. And exactly in the similar fashion, the gluteus minimus will take its origin from the lateral aspect of the ilium. Okay, and this will be between the anterior gluteal line. Okay, this was medius here. Minimus is here, anteriorly. Okay, between the anterior gluteal line, and one more line is here called as the inferior, from the apex of the greater sciatic notch okay, it is going here, and this is the inferior gluteal line. So between inferior and the this anterior gluteal line, this surface gives origin to the muscle, the minimus muscle. Okay, this gives origin to the minimus muscle. So let us see the origin of this muscle from this spine. And again, this muscle will also run downwards, forwards, and laterally. Downwards, far. Why laterally? Let us you understand here, okay, why it will go laterally. Right, if I just draw here, I mean say show you here in this, almost it is in anatomical position, okay. This is the greater trochanter and its lateral surface, and the muscle was coming from here to here. So naturally it has to go to the downwards, little forwards, and lot of lateral, okay, to the in the lateral direction it is going. So is true for the gluteus minimus, which is taking origin from the anterior aspect, okay. This will be also going to the greater, so it is going laterally, okay, it is going laterally. So let us see the insertion of this muscle. Again, a tendinous insertion, and this strong tendon will form here, and this strong tendon will get attachment onto the anterior aspect of greater trochanter. Where is the anterior aspect? Here. See, this is the anterior, where again a ridge is present, okay, onto that ridge, okay, onto the anterior aspect. See here, this is the, okay, you are seeing, right. This is the anterior aspect of the greater. This was the lateral aspect where oblique ridge was present. Here there is another ridge is present here onto the anterior aspect of the greater trochanter, where the gluteus minimus is going to insert. Okay, it will be inserted. So in this diagram, this is the site of the insertion onto the anterior, not onto the lateral here. This is the lateral site where this medius was inserting. This is, I have just drawn in anterior side. Now this is the muscle, gluteus minimus muscle, just a diagrammatic representation to gain attachment onto the anterior aspect of the greater trochanter. Axon, okay, axon will be the same. Just like that, it will be abductor of the thigh at the hip joint, okay? Okay, and now supply is also the same, superior gluteal knob, which was supplying to the medius, okay? This will supply to the minimus also. So it is abductor, and in the similar way, it can tilt the hip on the hip joint, okay? Pelvis, articulated pelvis, it can tilt towards the side of the contraction or towards the side the muscle is present, okay, it will tilt to the hip joint. And second action is, so both the muscles are very strong abductor of the thigh at the hip joint, okay, thigh. I hope that you have understood the gluteus medius and minimus. So now you are ready to understand what is the Trendelenburg sign, okay. What is the Trendelenburg's sign? Okay, let's go to the Trendelenburg sign now. Now, see here. Now, as I said that some people, they walk with the lurching gait, and this is due to paralysis of the gluteus medius and that of the minimus muscle. Now, in this diagrammatic representation, this is our vertebral column, and this trapezoid structure is nothing but a diagrammatic representation of our pelvis. And then on the sides, these are the two muscles shown here. That is the gluteus medius. This is the gluteus medius, and this is the gluteus minimus on this side as well as on other side. Medius and minimus muscle, and they are going, say for example, to the greater trochanter. This is the shaft of the femur, and this is the tibia, and this roundness structure indicate the foot, okay. So this is the knee joint, okay. So this is how a person is standing, okay, on both the foot here. He is standing, and while he is standing, Now, the muscles are not relaxed, they are having some contractions, okay? And why it is having some contraction when a person, a normal person is standing, okay? Because this will maintain the position of the pelvis, okay? Central position of pelvis is achieved because of contraction of the muscle from both the sides, right? Okay, so this is the normal position where both the muscles on both the sides, they are intact, okay? They are having no problem, okay? Now, suppose if you are tired of standing on one foot for long time, I mean say both the foot for long time, okay, as usually we do, we raise one of our foot, okay? We raise. So, this foot is raised here, okay? This is, foot is raised here. And when the foot is raised, that means your whole body is supported now only by one foot, okay, or one lower limb, it is supported. So the load is going through the one lower limb. That means where the foot is off the ground, okay, where the foot is off the ground, the muscle on that side are not contracting. That means which two muscle? That is the gluteus medius and gluteus minimus are not. So I have just represented them by a simple line because they are not contracting. But on the other hand, on the other side where the foot is on the ground, these two muscles, that is the medius and minimus, they are contracting, powerfully contracting. Why they are powerfully contracting? Because they want to bring this pelvis in normal position. Otherwise, pelvis where it is not contracting will try to sink towards the side where the foot is off the ground. Okay, there is no support. So the pelvis will tilt on that side. But to avoid the tilting of pelvis, the muscle on the normal side, I mean say where the foot is on the ground, that will contract excessively so that to maintain the normal position of the pelvis, or sometime there may be a little tilting, okay? That means it may push little upward on the side where the ground, where the foot is off the ground, followed? So when foot is off the ground, the muscle of the opposite side, that is where it is on the ground, of medius and minimus are contracting powerfully, excessively, so that the pelvis is not disturbed, so you can remain standing on one foot, okay, on one foot for some time or with support of some other thing, right? So this was the condition, again, when the muscles on both the sides are intact, there is no paralysis, normal, okay, normal, right? Now, but when these muscle on these sides are paralyzed and the muscle on opposite sides are intact, okay, now then if you just lift the foot, that is foot is off the ground, where the muscles are not paralyzed, they are normal. So it is as good as they are not acting. But on the opposite side, the muscle, that is the medius and minimus, they are paralyzed due to injury to the superior gluteal nerve. So this muscle cannot contract. The muscle cannot contract, and on other side the foot is off the ground. Okay, so what will happen? This muscle cannot pull this pelvis to this side, okay, to the paralyzed side. So the action which was taking place here is not available here, okay, and because of that, the where the foot is off the ground, that side of the pelvis will be tilted towards the side of the foot up. That is called as the sagging of the pelvis on the side where foot is off the ground. So to test a patient, if his muscle glutei, that is medius and minimus, if they are paralyzed, you ask the patient to stand on the one foot, that is on normal side where you are not suspecting the muscles are paralyzed. Then if the sagging takes place, that means the site on which the person is standing on foot, okay, on one side, that side is paralyzed. Okay, that this is called as where sagging takes place. Okay, this is called as the positive Trendelenburg sign. This is called as positive Trendelenburg sign. Now, this completes your answer to the question, what is a Trendelenburg sign and why it sign takes place, why it becomes positive, okay? And for that, it was needed to tell you about the origin, insertion, nerve supply, and action of the two abductor muscles of the hip, okay? That is gluteus medius and minimus, okay? This completes your answer to the question. Thank you very much for watching this video.